All right, guys, these are just two chapters. This is for your exit ticket. This is warning, this kid is rated R. I have warned Mom about August's face. I had described what he looks like. I did this because I know she's not always good at faking her feelings, and August was coming over for the first time today. I even sent her a text at work to remind her about it. But I could tell from the expression on her face when she came home after work that I hadn't prepared her enough. She was shocked when she came through the door and saw his face for the first time. "Hi, Mom, this is Augie. Can he stay for dinner?" I asked quickly. It took a second for my answer to even register. "Hi, Augie," she said. "Of course, sweetheart, if it's okay with Augie's mother." While Augie called his mother on the phone, on the cell phone, I whispered to Mom, Stop making that weirded out face. She had that look when she was watching the news and some horrific event had happened. She nodded quickly, like she hadn't realized she was making a face, and was really nice and normal to Augie afterwards. After a while, Augie and I got tired of working on our projects and went to hang out in the living room. Augie was looking at the pictures on the mantle, and he saw a picture of me and Daddy. "Is that your dad?" he asked. "Yeah. I don't know. I didn't know you were, what's the word, biracial?" "Right, that's the word. Yeah." He looked at the picture again. "Are your parents divorced? I've never seen him at drop-off or anything." "Oh, no," I said. "He was a platoon sergeant. He died a few years ago." "Whoa, I didn't know that." "Yeah," I nodded, handing him a picture of my dad in his uniform. "Whoa, look at all those medals." "Yeah, he was pretty awesome." "Whoa, Summer, I'm sorry." "Yeah, it sucks. I really miss him a lot." "Yeah, whoa," he nodded, handing me back the picture. "Have you ever known anyone who died?" I asked. "Just my grandmother. I don't really even remember." "That's too bad," Augie nodded. "You ever wonder what happens to people when they die?" I asked. He shrugged. "Not really. I mean, I guess they go to heaven. That's where my grands went." "I think about it a lot," I said. "I think when people die, their souls go to heaven, but just for a little while. Like, that's where they see their old friends and stuff and kind of catch up on old times. But when I actually think the souls start thinking about their lives on earth, if they were good or bad or whatever, and then they get born again as brand new babies in the world." "Why would you want to do that?" "Because then you get another chance to get it right," I answered. "Their souls get a chance to do a do-over." He thought about what I was saying and then nodded. "Kind of like when you get a makeup test," he said. "Right. But they don't come back looking the same," he said. "I mean, they look completely different when they came back, right?" "Oh, yeah," I answered. Your soul stays the same, but everything else is different." "I like that," he said, nodding a lot. "I really like that, Summer. That means in my next life, I won't be stuck with this face." He pointed to his face when he said that and batted his eyes, which made me laugh. "I guess not," I shrugged. "Hey, I might even be handsome," he said, smiling. "That would be so awesome, wouldn't it? I could come back and be this good-looking dude and be super buff and tall." I laughed again. He was such a good sport about himself. That's one of the things I liked most about Augie. "Hey, Augie, can I ask you a question?" "Yeah," he said, like he knew exactly what I wanted to ask. I hesitated. Been wanting to ask for a while, but I've always lost the guts. "What?" he said. "You want to know what's wrong with my face?" "Yeah, I guess, if that's okay for me to ask." He shrugged. I was so relieved that he didn't seem mad or sad. "Yeah, it's no big deal," he said casually. "The main thing I have is this thing called mandibulofacial dystosis, which took me forever to learn how to pronounce, by the way. But I also have this other syndrome that I can't even pronounce. And these things kind of just morph together into one big super thing, which is so rare they don't even have a name for it. I mean, I don't want to brag or anything, but I'm actually considered something of a medical wonder, you know?" He smiled. "That was a joke," he said. "You can laugh." I smiled and shook my head. "You're funny, Augie," I said. "Yes, I am," he said proudly. "I am cool beans." All right, our last chapter for the day, the Egyptian tomb. Over the next month, Augie and I hung out a lot after school, either at his house or my house. Augie's parents even invited Mom and me over for dinner a couple times. I overheard them talking about Mom fixing up on a blind date with August's uncle, Ben. On the day of the Egyptian Museum exhibit, we were all really excited and kind of giddy. It had snowed the day before, not as much as it snowed over Thanksgiving break, but still, snow is snow. The gym was turned into a giant museum with everyone's Egyptian artifact displayed on a table with a little caption card explaining what the thing was. Most of the artifacts were really great, but I have to say, I really think mine and August were the best. My sculpture of the Anubis looked pretty real, and I had even used a real gold paint on it. And August had made his step pyramid out of sugar cubes. It was 2 feet high and 2 feet long, and he even spray painted the cubes with this kind of fake sand paint or something. It looked so awesome. We all dressed up in Egyptian costumes. Some of the kids were Indiana Jones type archaeologists. Some of them dressed up as pharaohs. August and I dressed up as mummies. Our faces were covered except for two little holes from the eyes and one little hole for the mouth. When the parents showed up, they all lined up in the hallway in the front of the gym. Then we were told we could go to get our parent, and each kid got to take his or her parent on a flashlight tour through the dark gym. August and I took our moms around together. We stopped at each exhibit, explaining what it was, talking in whispers, answering questions. Since it was dark, we used our flashlights to illuminate the artifacts while we were talking. Sometimes the dramatic effect, we would hold the flashlight under our chins while we were explaining something in detail. It was so much fun hearing all these whispers in dark, seeing all the lights zigzagging around the room. At one point, I went over to get a drink of water from the water fountain. I had to take the mummy wrap off my face. "Hey, Summer," said Jack, who came over to talk to me. He was dressed like a man from the mummy. "Cool costume." "Thanks. Is the other mummy August?" "Yeah." "Hey, do you know why August is mad at me?" "Uh-huh," I nodded. "Can you tell me?" "No," he nodded. He seemed bum. "I told him I wouldn't tell you," I explained. "It's so weird," he said. "I have no idea why he's mad at me all of a sudden. None. Can you at least give me a hint?" I looked over where August was across the room, talking to our moms. I wasn't about to break my solid oath that I wouldn't tell anyone about what he overheard at Halloween, but I felt bad for Jack. "Bleeding scream," I whispered in his ear, and then walked away. All right, and that is the last chapter for today. Make sure that you do your exit ticket.